Welcome to the Stories in EDU podcast, the show where we talk with real educators and hear their powerful impact. Their stories will grab you, inspire you, and show you the reach of the work we do. And now, the Bretzman Group presents your hosts, Josh Gauthier and Mandy Taylor.
Hey, everybody. Welcome back to another great episode of Stories in EDU, where we just talk about some of the great stories of lots of different educators, past lives in education or current lives or what they're looking to do in the future. We've had a bunch of great episodes so far. This is actually our 10th episode, which is just crazy. And I think I'm saying the same superlatives as I did when we did our 9th episode. So I got to work on changing up my vocabulary. I think we need more ELA teachers on here, Mandy.
Okay. I'll put that on my list.
All right. Good. Good. I think we've already had a few. I'm just not learning very quickly. So Mandy, how are things going with you?
Things are well. It is, we've been testing this week, so it's nice to kind of have that done out of the way and now come up with some action plans. I'm part of a team at our school that kind of comes in. We kind of call ourselves a SWAT. Like we do it for like universal screener. So now I've heard the same things over and over. I'm like feeling very I'm excited to get jazzed up here because I've been kind of bored for 4 days.
Yeah, this must be a universal thing because our school is testing all week too. Yeah. So, I mean, they had their on-demand writing prompts in ELA. They had STAR. They had SRI. It's like good thing it wasn't standardized testing time. These kids are probably slowed.
It's poor babies. I know.
And then we're throwing a 3-day week at them next week. So today must have been just crazy for teachers, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Well, great to have you with me once again. You are the best co-host I could ask for. And bringing on our next guest, we want to introduce Robin Hosemann to you. Robin, thanks for coming on the podcast.
Hi, thanks for having me. It's fun to be here talking with you today, tonight.
Tonight, yeah, whenever it is. I mean, and whenever you're listening, it could be like whenever.
True.
So, just know, we're recording tonight, so if we sound a little tired, that's why.
There you go.
It's a Friday night that we're recording this. So if you listen to it on like a Monday morning, we apologize. We'll try and keep the energy level real high.
Yeah.
Robin, why don't you tell us a little bit about who you are and what you got going on right now?
Sure. So I'm in kind of a different place in my career right now. I spent 16 years in education as a public school teacher, and I began teaching in the Chicago public school system right out of college. I graduated from DePaul University, and their program was really strongly rooted in social justice training for educators and really, you know, getting us to interrogate our position of power and privilege in the classroom and what that meant for our students. So I was really energized and excited to go into urban education at the time of my graduation. And I had a fantastic school and amazing community that I worked in for 4 years there. And then our family situation changed and I moved to rural Wisconsin, which is where my family has always had a farm. And I was going to take a little break from teaching. I was hitting that 4-year mark where a lot of teachers do end up stepping away. And I'm really grateful that a family friend stepped in and said, you should apply for this ELA position in a middle school in a town of about 200, you know, so I went from urban environment to a really small town and taught there for about 9 years, middle school. And it was a fantastic experience for me. And both my experience in Chicago and in rural Wisconsin has been amazing. And then in 2010, our outgoing school librarian brought a flyer to me about the WISE program for training rural school librarians. And so I jumped into that program and it was truly transformative in terms of how to connect students with resources and really engage them in meaningful use of technology and media literacy. And I became really passionately engaged at that point. So I was in a school library for 2 years and then this was 2 years ago. I stepped away from working in the library setting and jumped into kind of a great unknown in my life. I started doing some educational consulting, curriculum development, and then had an amazing opportunity to join the Breathe for Change program, which is a yoga training for teachers. So it's focused on training educators who are interested in becoming registered yoga teachers through this very intense 16-day, 200-hour program. And I did that last summer. And through that, I really got connected with the understanding of teacher wellness and what impact teacher wellness has on student achievement. So a friend of mine, a yoga teacher who I brought in to work with some teacher friends and I in the rural school system, she and I partnered up recently to develop training programs for teachers. So that's my current project, and I'm really
excited.
Yeah.
That's so exciting. Like, so I keep a notebook where I just kind of take notes as people are talking so that I can kind of keep everything straight in my mind.
Sure.
I'm like,
I talk really fast too. So
no, not at all. But just kind of, it's always fascinating to me is how people end up where they end up. And I think it's fascinating to me because my view has always been very small. Like, I'm even living in the house that I grew up in. My husband and I bought it from my parents when I was pregnant with my daughter. They wanted a smaller place. We wanted a bigger place. And so I teach, well, I am an instructional coach now, but just so fascinating to me. I mean, it's so small. And so Twitter and personalized professional development has really given me this opportunity to connect with people that I don't get to do just on a daily basis because, you know, and I like the idea of being here and my kids going to school in this community and things like that. But it's also so fascinating to me to hear about other journeys and how people kind of end up where they do and just the work that you did with social justice and then moving to librarians. And then now as an instructional coach, I'm so focused on teachers mm-hmm. instead of students. I mean, I'm certainly, my ultimate goal is increased student performance and engagement and happiness right. for the kids. And what I'm finding is that the work that I do with teachers, a lot of my work with them is just to empower them to do more things, to feel better about the work that they do, to, you know, it's a morale health thing as much as it is pedagogy, you know, so it's
absolutely
fascinating to kind of hear where you've ended up. And then like you were talking about how teacher wellness impacts student achievement. So I'm fascinated to hear more about that. And I've always been so frightened of yoga. My sister does it, but I'm always like, okay, that's probably not for me, but I'm interested in the parts that would be beneficial, you know.
Absolutely.
For me.
Yeah.
So that's neat.
I love hearing more. I want to hear more about your story too, because I love the idea of returning or staying in a community and returning and being an educator in a community mm-hmm. that you've grown up in. I think that's fantastic. So many great points to respond to there. And first of all, I guess I would say, while the Brief for Change program is transformative and it's sweeping the nation, there's an amazing opportunity. There are amazing opportunities in lots of different cities coming up this next year. They've expanded their offerings and their ability to reach, and their whole philosophy is changing the world one teacher at a time. So the belief okay. that, like you said, teacher empowerment ultimately impacts students is huge. And my partner, Kathy O'Rourke, my yoga teacher, she and I have just kind of zeroed in on this, and she didn't really realize it at the time. I cold called her one afternoon to see if she would come teach yoga to our little staff of 10. After school in this small school of about 120 kids, a rural elementary school. And she jumped in, and it was just this amazing time because it was a stressful time. There was leadership changes in the district and just a lot of factors that were beyond our control. And that hour once a week was just a really amazing shift that our staff could experience together. And so that kind of was always in the back of my brain. Mm-hmm. And yoga has been a part of my life for about 20 years, but not as seriously as it's been since I jumped into the teacher training aspect of it. It's deepened my practice, it's deepened my experience with it, but also it's exposed me to issues of inclusivity and diversity in yoga. So there's this kind of myth that yoga is for one kind of body, one kind of style mm-hmm. of person who's interested in, invested in health and wellness right. in a very certain right. way. But really, there are so many amazing people doing work in yoga for everybody. And I ended up having a major injury a couple of years ago, and or a significant shoulder injury, and kind of had to set things aside. And I started back up in a class of senior citizens doing yoga. I was, you know, the younger person, but I still had a similar experience of, you know, coming from kind of a place of being broken in a lot of ways and finding my way back. So really finding ways to offer mindful movement and not necessarily scare people off with the idea of yoga. You know, so it's,
it sounds like my speed.
Totally.
I mean, my sister will talk about things and I'm like, and I'm out. Like, no, you know, like not this girl. So,
Well, yeah. And I think really helping people find what works for their bodies is really important. And that's also what I think is important for kids. And you had mentioned the impact of teacher mindset on student wellness. Mm-hmm. And the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation and Penn State did this amazing study in 2016, and they just published it, I think, last year. And it's really looking at the impact of teacher wellness on student achievement. So that's been a real foundational piece for my partner and I as we build our work to bring this to schools. And we really wanted to bring it to the places that might not have it. So our school district, Southwestern Wisconsin, here is where we're starting. So
that's such a great way to approach it. So different, you know, and it's not out there. I mean, it's certainly something that is trendy is the wrong word, but it is one of those things that a lot of people, I think, have a definite, you either like you're really interested or you're really confused by it, or, you know, and so I think it's interesting to bring it to groups of people that might not be so comfortable. Yes. That's kind of what I'm thinking. Like, if this is something that I said to our staff, you know, I think some people would be like, what?
Yeah. I was with some friends the other day and they're like, oh, I don't think we want to go to your yoga class. And I was like, just come, I swear. It's not like, it's not going to be quite what you might think it would be. So,
it's fascinating.
And just like we work with all students, I think we need to think about the diversity of our teachers too, and what they're experiencing.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, and now that I'm out of the classroom, I was in the classroom for 17 years and then have been an instructional coach for the last three. And that process of leaving the classroom is so strange too.
Totally.
Because your focus is completely different. And my identity for such a long time was on the kids and how they responded to me and knowing that I made an impact, and leaving that working with adults largely is, I mean, I still get to interact with kids often just because I'm at a campus. So I still get, you know, I know the kids and I get to interact with them, but my focus is on the teachers so that they can focus on the kids and just looking for ways to support them without being annoying, to be, you know, build capacity without making them more stressed out than they already are, you know, and just kind of trying to find ways to, you know, just empower teachers ultimately has been so interesting, because all of my training and work was for kids, how to do that for kids. And so I really had to seek out, ways, you know, to work with adults better. Because that's something that, you know, that first year I was so confused by. I was like, "What? Wait, I just, you know, it's completely a different game when you're with adults largely." So that's
great. I can definitely relate to that that shift in perspectives and walking away. I shouldn't say walking away, but stepping away was really almost traumatic for me. I made it in a kind of an empowered decision making moment. It still took a long time for me to refine who I was as an educator. And I think I was hitting a lot of that. Like, if you step away from the classroom, you're not truly a teacher.
Right.
So I've just done a lot of work, like grappling with that and asking myself, well, what way feels right to me after 16 years of this? What am I transforming or evolving into in terms of what I can give back in education? So really focusing on teachers feels like a good fit for me right now.
It's taken me 3 years to kind of feel that same way, but it definitely, you know, I've talked to, there was a new coach on Twitter that I kind of, she's like, I just got a job as a coach and now I'm, now I don't know what to, now I'm panicked, you know, I kind of like side, I, you know, just kind of message her privately, and her and I just kind of really talked, because it was a really, it was like, I mean, traumatic is the word you use. It was very, very much more emotional than I thought it was going to be. I remember the first time my daughter got sick, and she's at the school where I work, and the first time she got sick and my principal told me to take her home. And I was like, well, I can, maybe my husband can come get her, maybe my mom. And he was like, just take her home. And I, what should have been a blessing, like what should have been, so I got home with her and I cried, because I'm sitting there crying. And then I was like, what are you doing? Like, what? And it was because I didn't feel important, is what I finally was able to kind of grasp, is that I don't need a sub. It, nobody cares if I'm not there. I didn't, you know, it's fine. People can work without me. Like, and so in my mind, it really messed with my identity, the impact I have on people. What is it that I really do? Is it important work? And that's always been important to me. And it's been so interesting to kind of grapple with that, and definitely some growing of my own, just kind of, like you said, where do I fit? What do I do now? If you're not really a teacher and people don't, you know, there's that, I don't have that street cred anymore. And it was really fascinating for me. So it's exciting to hear that other people have kind of felt that same dissonance, you know, when you're trying to kind of not reinvent yourself, but, you know, certainly just kind of feel comfortable in what you're doing at the in the present.
Yeah. And feeling your way through just, like you said, I guess like using the word traumatic was a little bit overstating it, I guess, in a way. And I want to be mindful and respectful of trauma that's different from what I'm talking about. But I guess it was like a rupture in my identity as an educator, for sure. And like you said, that emotional, figuring out where you fit and just, how to navigate. And I work as an outdoor educator part-time. So I still have contact with students, but it's completely different. And I also substitute for some friends' classes. So I get that, but it's so different from having your own class.
Your own babies. Oh, yeah.
Yes. It's completely different. So it's been a really, really, really interesting journey for sure.
So here's something I think about often, as I have a couple of things I was noodling around. Just like I said, like I sit back and I just listen, because there's you two, like the conversations are great. And I almost feel like this is the time for me to listen and learn some things. So that was wonderful to hear. First thing I think of, and I think about this often, I haven't really worked in any other industry. Like I've been an educator pretty much since I got out of college. You know, I mean, I did other things throughout, but I mean, they were your kind of your rudimentary low level job type things. Mm-hmm. So when I think about education and this conversation about identity and like the fact that when you go from being in the classroom, outside of the classroom, you know, you don't feel as important and all of that stuff. And how, I mean, it's so like uniquely personal of a profession that like, do other professions have this conversation? Like, oh, I went from lower management to middle management. Like, oh God, I don't know who I am anymore. Like, you think that happens?
Interesting. That's such a good question, Josh. Like, I don't know. That's interesting.
Well, I will say this. I know I mentioned my sister earlier. She is a managing partner at an accounting firm in Austin. And she has decided, after years of doing this and being very successful in that work, that she wants to be a speaker, that she wants to work with empowering women and in the workplace and all of this. And so she's actually launching that business and leaving this accounting firm next month. And so I know that for her, it is a complete identity shift, that it's something that she's working through and trying to, you know, cope and, you know, not so much because of the work with kids, you know, like that kind of thing, but just, this is what she did. This is the money she made. This is what how busy she was. This is this. And how then do I transition into this new role that may be a much slower pace, that may be a different, you know, income level, no one really knows, you know, and just this huge risk of what's this going to do for my family? How is this going to affect, you know, the kids? What is this going to look like? And, you know, so it's frightening, but, you know, I mean, I don't know. I just know in that one specific case, that's something that her and I've talked about a lot, but I think one of the biggest things with teachers, it's so personal. It's so personal. And that's what I've learned as a coach. When we talk about change, a lot of times teachers feel like that means everything I did before wasn't important, or everything now you're saying is invalid, because if I'm supposed to do this way, then how I did it last week wasn't right, you know, and that's not really true. That's not the messaging that I hope that I'm giving, you know, certain times, but I think because we're so emotionally attached to the work we do, it can feel that way. So we have to find ways to make it not that threatening.
Sure. Yeah. And that kind of speaks to the, what I was thinking about with the evolution and the arc of our careers, or the arc of our experience in education. And Josh, you know, you said you hadn't had any other job besides going to school, or, you know, being in schools. And when you think about it, from being, you know, preschool, kindergarten through teaching in mm-hmm. a classroom, you've been in that daily school environment for so long, decades and decades. And that evolution of how we see ourselves in the ecosystem of schools and education is really interesting. And for so long, I just saw myself as teacher, you know. And now it's just like, where is that teaching? Where do I shift that teaching? And actually, my organization is named Teacher Evolution. So it's the idea of evolving the inner teacher in ways that helps you show up differently to the practice of education.
You know, and that was the second point I was actually going to touch on, was when you mentioned that word evolve, mm-hmm. You know, that really, really made a light bulb kind of hit for me in that, you know, I don't know if that conversation ever happens with our classroom teachers about how have they evolved over the course of their career. Are they the same teacher they were when they started, or like when they first became a veteran teacher 5-6 years in, like now they're 20 years in, have they evolved? And the other connection I make with that, sorry, this is going to be, two. They're going to be progressively get cheesier. so my favorite band is Imagine Dragons right now. I actually happen to have but their last album was called Evolve. And about kind of how they're evolving as a band. And they're probably their most popular song from that is Believer.
Right.
And they talk about how, you know, through the pain, they've made themselves a believer in themselves. And that, I guess we probably don't all experience pain, or at least in different ways, but, you know, how do we evolve through our experiences in education? I thought was interesting, to which point I, when Jason gets to this part in the episode, I want him to name it the one where we evolve with Robin. that's kind of the naming trend he's had so far. So that's my vote. Hopefully he picks
cool.
that one. And the last thing, this is, I apologize, it's going to go off the deep end of like nerdiness. But in Pokemon, your character evolve, right? And most people probably know Pokemon from Pokemon Go, but I know Pokemon from like the Game Boy game from, you know, back when I was a kid and, sorry, I dropped a pen. back when I was a kid in 2000 and not even 2000, like late 90s, early 2000s. And in that game, you catch all these creatures and the creatures can evolve into more powerful versions. And as the game goes on, like you need to have more powerful things. And so it wouldn't make sense to have like this little low level, like Caterpie when you get to the end of the game, when you could have like, you know, the high level other things. You know, if you don't know Pokemon, it's not going to matter if I spit out any
names. My kids do. And so I'm trying to pick up like Charizard or.
Yeah.
Right.
Right. Like I'm trying to say words that I've heard them say.
better one. Like Charmander, not at the end of the game. Like cute, yes. Fighter, no. But you want the Charizard. And so I think as educators, like, you know, we start off as that Charmander, you know, we have our little flame, but it's easily, you know, extinguished early on and we don't know how to use it. But, you know, as we go forward, we need to, you know, become that Charizard of teaching which, you know, we kind of find in our own way. Like, I think Mandy is finding through coaching, and you're finding through the yoga and teacher wellness thing. So anyways,
yeah,
nerd rant over.
No, that was really good, Josh. I so related to it because my son brought Pokemon into my life when he was like 3 or 4. He wanted me to figure out how to play the game and with the cards. So I just remember it, and I just like rolled or unfolded the game mat and like tried to read inside predictions, like figure out which like what our decks were gonna be, and I was so overwhelmed. But through learning that process, we had such a blast. And so the idea of evolving through a Pokemon character, that's really relatable to me. And I of course was like always choosing characters based on how they looked and how cute they were, and not necessarily like what they're hi there.
So my 14-year-old is like, are y'all talking about Pokemon?
We are totally talking about Pokemon.
And he's like, what are you doing? Like, what are you saying? And I was like, okay, now I have a co-host.
Parental chat about Pokemon. It's probably pretty goofy, but Josh, I'll defer to you on all Pokemon things. But yeah, I think that idea of like, what are the threads that carry you through from the start of your career? For wherever you are in it. And I really think for me, like I started out talking about the social justice training that I received at DePaul, or the emphasis that was placed in our education pre-service work. And I think that thread has been really consistent in my practice, and something that I've been dedicated to always looking at, like, what's my power? What's my privilege? How does that work in the roles that I take on? And then how do we help others see where they're influencing, where they have areas of influence in the classroom, and how do we empower students to take ownership and really find their own voices in schools? And I think that ultimately that can't happen unless you have well leadership, unless you have healthy functioning educators and school leaders and healthy school culture that's really examining those things. So I appreciate that evolution sidebar, Josh. It's a good one. So many great themes to fly off of.
Indeed,
Robin,
yeah.
What is I'm not trying to put you on the spot, but be thinking about maybe some resources for teachers that are interested in learning more about social justice practices, or even just research or things that even practical ways that, you know, I know it's something that I think is so long overdue. Mm-hmm. And there are a lot of places still that haven't had those conversations. And I know that it's something that I'm trying to improve personally, and is just kind of learning more about ways to kind of confront certain things and how to kind of challenge and empower the kids teachers and then the kids. So be thinking about things that we could even put like in the show notes or that you can just.
Yeah. Fantastic. I think about how when I shifted to rural education and how I was feeling pretty isolated in that work in terms of being connected to educators who are pushing the envelope or thinking outside the box, because it's just smaller staff sizes, you're just kind of like in your own silo. And when I finally joined the library media program and I was pushed into social media, like I was a non-social media person, like the last of my friends and family to get on Facebook, but our professors were saying, you know, get on Twitter, follow voices that you wouldn't otherwise consider. And so that's been my biggest recommendation, is like, follow people who are not like you.
Like you.
Like, look for other people and then start really listening and trying to understand. And that's been huge for me. So I'll share some of the resources I've used to do that. And also just kind of what the wellness piece is for social justice and how that comes to play.
All right. Thank you.
Sure.
Beautiful. Well, I think we need to begin to wrap this up. In our dedication to try and make this as commute friendly as possible, I think it's now become a there and back podcast, but that's okay, because something to look forward to at the end of the day. So Robin, it has been an excellent conversation, and just there's so many different threads that we could follow and have like 15 episodes just with you. And I think with any teacher, really, I mean, there's so much to unpack from that many years of experience.
Thanks. It's been great talking with you both too.
All right. So we are going to wrap up as we always do with the personalized PD game of stories. Okay. And I actually have a timer tonight. So it took till episode 10, but I have one. Now the next part is figuring out how to share my screen with the participants so they can see it too. So here's our card for tonight. It is incorporate movement. Tell a story about how you incorporate movement into your classroom. When and why do you have students move? Is it part of the learning process, or is it used as a transition? Have you used commercial breaks during your class, or have you tried gonoodle.com? All right. Robin,
dog just joined.
How do you incorporate dogs into the classroom?
We have dogs. We have 14-year-olds. We don't know.
Right. It's great.
I'm in this office. I just have like a 10-year-old girl's stuff behind me and then my Saturn V, but I don't have.
Is that an epic cat tree though? I'm seeing
this.
Like,
this is my brother-in-law built this for us. It's awesome.
Okay. So we've got all kinds of things.
All right. I'm going to sidebar our way to going beyond the 1 minute anyways. Okay.
Okay.
Robin, you're up first. I'm going to find the timer and set it and share my screen so that we can all enjoy being on time.
Okay, fantastic.
You can go ahead.
Okay, so I just came from doing about 6 weeks of mindful movement with first, second, and third graders once a week for about 30 minutes with each group and their teacher. So we came together in one group, it's in their classroom, and the other two come to a gym area where we roll out the yoga mats. And I just work with the students in terms of teaching some of the poses that are animal shape inspired, nature inspired, and they really have a great time. But what's so cool about it is the first week, second week, total chaos. You know, you're just trying to organize students and their bodies in space and also get them to pay attention to their breath and their minds and all of that. But by week six, we had kids moving through the sequence absolutely silently and really tuning into themselves and in this great community of movement. So that would be my mindful movement story for a minute.
Nice.
There we go.
Money.
That really helps, Josh. Like, that really helps.
I know, that's slick. I know. I learn. I'm evolving right in front of your very eyes.
There you go. Nice.
I hope I grow like wings and like bazooka.
I mean, for real.
Robin, what age group was the...
That was first, second, and third graders.
So. Oh, wow.
Yeah, and their teachers, which was awesome. Was
super very cool. So you had the teachers doing it with them?
Yeah. And that was just a phenomenal experience for both me and the teachers, I think, reflected back to me that they just had a sense of calm and a sense of connection and just a way that centers a group of human beings that share space together.
That's cool. Love the way that you just talk about all of it. It makes me feel very calm.
Oh, awesome.
Her personality is like just super chill. I'm like,
like she does a lot of yoga, right?
I try to show up.
All right. Here we go. Mandy, you ready?
Yes. So when I was in the classroom, I certainly did use Go Noodle. We did do lots of brain breaks and transitions just because, the oldest grade I worked with was third. So there was always a constant need for that movement. But even just with this last week, like I mentioned earlier, just testing all week, I got this Apple Watch for Christmas and I haven't determined yet if I enjoy it or what I like. But what I do think is funny is every once in a while it'll say, you need to stand, you need to breathe, you need to, and it's ironic to me that the technology is telling me to do those things. But it's been so interesting how when doing that, it kind of does make me pause for a minute and say, okay, I need to be aware of what I'm doing. I need to change my environment. I need to not be so kind of wrapped up in this particular thing. And I've been so surprised how that one little tweak or tool has I feel like helped me. Period. That was I can't break the rule. I can't break the
so
rule.
Great.
I had to stop talking.
You ended so well.
Awesome.
Helped me. Yes. Perfect. That was great. That's really good.
I'm beginning to realize that I should be writing my answers down to these because I'm going to get to a point where we repeat these cards and I might use the same thing. And I I'm gonna like kick myself for that.
We need version two. We need debt two.
Yes. Yes.
Mandy, I just wanted to comment really quickly. I think that you touched on something that could be a whole nother podcast story thing, but how far we are removed from our bodies. Like,
yes.
I mean, we're in the age of information. We're overloaded. We're so cerebral and always on in terms of reading, thinking, mm-hmm. engaging, but like really being able to check in with ourselves and where we're at is huge. So I love that technology can nudge you toward that, you know, reestablishing something
right?
with your body. That's awesome.
It does feel wrong though. Like I'm like, the watch is telling me to take a breath. Like, why can't I just do that? Like, is that done? Like, is that opposite? It seems so backwards, but
no, I think culturally we're mm-hmm. just bombarded by not being at home in our bodies right. as much. So yeah, you're not alone.
Excellent. All right. See, the reason I brought up the sharing thing was that I feel like I shared this already, but maybe I didn't. All right, here we go.
Okay.
So I like getting kids up and moving. And when I taught in a computer lab, which makes that kind of challenging. So there are a couple of different things I did, but one of my favorite projects that I ever did, that I don't know if it was super heavy on the learning, but it was heavy on the movement. we did geocaching. So we got like 6 GPS units from the charter school. And we had a little nature preserve out back when I taught in the Denmark school district. And I hit out some tubs and then they would start and then the answer would lead them to the next one or something like that. Like either they would, you know, just be a question and have to answer it. And then the coordinates would be on the sheet for the next one. And then they would just go through and, you know, it was a little review for something, but we got to walk like, you know, 5 minutes away from the school and we got to just trudge around and be outside and they could be, you know, a little crazy and, you know, the administration couldn't hear them. So that was fun.
That's really cool.
All right.
Wow. Get it. Nice.
That was slick. I like
it. We survived our first actual lightning round and not monsoon, rainstorm. Talk for 48 minutes about the 1 minute question.
That's great. That's a
beautiful.
Great question, though. Beautiful. I really love that that pack of cards. That seems really cool.
Yes, they're awesome. I think they're like $15 for one or $20 for two. I'm not like trying to sell them, but seriously, if you buy them, they're pretty awesome. They're great for your staff and for all those things. So, or for this, you know, conversation with colleagues.
Awesome.
All right, Robin, before we head off and end the podcast, do you want to share where people can learn more about what you're doing or working on?
Sure. Well, you can always find me on Twitter at Robin Hosemann. And I'm a little bit less on Facebook, but also on Instagram quite a bit. And our new home online will be teacherevolution.com. We're in the works of getting that domain from an awesome teacher who's granted us he's been willing to sell it. So teacherevolution.com is coming up soon, and we'd love to see you and connect with you there if you're interested in teacher wellness and how it impacts student achievement.
Excellent. Oh, well, Mandy, we have made it through 10.
Congrats, woo! Guys.
Which means, I guess, it's really important.
I feel like we need some confetti or
right something or something. Like that. Really, right now, all my concern is making sure that Jason knows that this has to be the 10th and the last one has to be the 9th because we
right because we've said
it in the episode. but hey, hopefully, it's here to 100 or 200 and beyond. This has been fun.
Definitely.
All right. Well, thank you for listening to Stories in EDU. We're always happy to have you as a listener to our podcast. Whether you're listening to it on iTunes or Stitcher or Libsyn or on YouTube, it doesn't really matter. We just are happy to be able to share and amplify teacher stories and hopefully get inspired, learn something new, or feel like you can take a new direction or evolve in your own career. We'd love to help you in any way we can just by listening, and we look forward to bringing you some more great teacher stories in the coming weeks. So thanks for listening.
Thank you for tuning in to the Stories in EDU podcast. Please be sure to subscribe and leave us a review. Until next time, thanks again.